As we reported earlier, President Trump visited the African American Museum of History and Culture today, spending time considering the struggle to overcome racism in the United States. Tonight, another installment in our series, Race Matters, focused on finding solutions to racism. Special correspondent Charlayne Hunter-Gault reports from Athens, Georgia, on building bridges through the game of chess.
If we're going to be here for the next.
This is one of Lemuel LaRouche's day jobs, teaching graduate students in the University of Georgia's School of Social Work.
We turn all these into a circle.
But LaRouche is a man of many parts, one who doesn't separate town from gown, especially the parts of town populated by troubled youth.
These kids are looking for opportunities, looking for way out, bouncing from foster home to foster homes.
And to that end, LaRouche puts all of his teaching skills to work with troubled and not so troubled youth and others from other places with chess, the game he loves and sees as more than a game.
While in Israel, I got an opportunity to play chess with this old Russian man. And although we didn't speak the same language, while we hit the chessboard, as we were playing chess, I kind of stepped outside of myself and realized, like, wow, and how I was able to connect with this person that even though we didn't speak the same language, we were able to connect through the chessboard.
But you learned something from it.
Yes, yes.
What was it that you learned?
What I took from that lesson was more of this is a game that can really unify races. This is a game that can really unify people. Chess is such a metaphor for life. When I teach chess, I try to teach it from the perspective of how do you take this game and correlate it with the real world. And when teaching children how to play chess, I try to teach them how to look at the world different. The saying goes, when you give a man fish, he eats for a day. When you teach a man how to fish, he eats for a lifetime. I try to apply the same concept with chess.
I have to think more critically, and I have to focus more, because in chess, if you mess up a move, then you could basically throw your whole game off. So you really need to think about what you do before you do it.
But you also began to close spaces, mm-hmm, between black children and white children and Latin children. Tell me how you did that.
Adults are programmed in their own viewpoints, their political views, their religious views, but kids are still innocent. So if we can succeed at putting children together, getting children to shake hands, look into each other's eyes, have that socialization in where they can engage and touch each other in a positive way, and when that child becomes a mayor or a commissioner or is put in a position, he or she has an experience or have had an experience with African-American youth. So using chess as a tool to bring kids together, we do it through chess and pizza, chess and ice cream, where we bring these kids together. That, in essence, forced the parents to come together. And before we know it, you know, we have a community that's really beginning to build collectively.
And they begin to understand each other beyond chess?
Indeed, because that's important. Oftentimes, chess is just used as a hook to bring them to the table. But beyond chess, now that I have a relationship with you, if I've been programmed to see you as a criminal, as a thug, as racist, chess is a way for you to have that one-on-one interaction. And now I realize that, man, who I thought was a thug just beat me in chess.
What this is doing is helping me learn in life that you have to think ahead and plan ahead before you move.
What happens when the police play chess with these kids?
To watch the police officers engage with youth in a game of chess is, to me, a brilliant thing. One is because a lot of times the way we've been programmed and conditioned to see each other, kids have been programmed to hate the police based on historical mistrust, as well as relationships that they've had with parents, or if they've seen a police officer incarcerate their parents. So there's a negative stereotype about police officers in our community. And oftentimes, police officers have been programmed to see a lot of young African-American youth as criminals because of the things that they've dealt with. Engaging the kids with the police officers in a game of chess, it helps both the youth as well as the police officers to break the stereotypes that we've developed about each other.
And you get reactions from?
Very positive reactions, because one, the kid now recognizes he's seen the police officer smile. There's positive socialization. People are beginning to engage with each other. The police officer is telling the kid, man, you beat me in chess. It develops a relationship that you don't see. So once a year we have what's called justice served. And this is a way for the kids to whoop up on the police officers through chess, but all in positive interaction.
So for communities where they don't have a chess master or even a griot, mm-hmm. Are there lessons beyond chess, you think? When you have these divisions, how do you bridge those gaps?
By bringing people together.
How? It's, you can't just stand on the street and say, y'all come, we're gonna get together tonight.
By building what we've built locally in Athens, it was a process. You first have to allow those who are in positions of power to engage with people who are affected by policies that are being drawn. So to get both in a room, we've helped to strengthen that process through our annual chess conference. This is a conference that brings policymakers in a room with kids that are affected by the policies.
But now you're talking about chess. I want to talk about how you do it if you don't have chess as the centerpiece.
I truly believe that it's important to try to reach them at the youth, at the ground level.
Who has to take the lead? What kind of people do you think need to get engaged in this? And how do they go about bringing this in?
If we begin to look at things as we all are small pieces of a big puzzle, then that helps to make the picture a lot more clearer. The great W.E.B. Du Bois said that the problem with the 20th century is going to be the problem of the color line. And it's sad that in 21st century, we still find ways to erase that color line or find a way to turn that line into a circle where we can include everyone. I'm optimistic because I see how we engage the youth on the ground. I see what happens when we engage little white boys, little white girls, and you know, Asian and Hispanic. When we bring the kids together, I see that type of engagement that they have. I see the genuineness in it. And I'm in a position that when I see the parenting of the parents, where the kids are repeating what they hear from the parents, then it's an opportunity for me to redirect that concept, redirect that thought. So by engaging the youth on the ground, having them engage, talk to each other, having them play with each other, socialize with each other, I believe that that is one way that we can erase it. And it's about allowing those who have been programmed to see you a certain way, or how we've been programmed to see other people certain ways, that we really begin to have that genuine dialogue, that genuine interaction, and I try to do that through my work. But I'm very optimistic that it can happen. It's tough, but it can happen.
Thank you very much, Lemuel LaRouche, for joining us.
Thank you so much. It's an honor.